crooked. I was gonna say crooked, and that's not a word. So hi everyone, Moisy here, back with another video. Today we're gonna be recapping Love is Blind season 2. So to start off with, let's talk about the people. So we have 6 couples. I read that there were actually like 7 to 8 people who actually met in the pods, like 7 to 8 couples, but I guess they only chose like the top 6, and I wonder how they chose it. Like, did they choose based off of drama? Maybe they chose based off of like people the audience would more likely gravitate to, like attractiveness, I wonder. We'll talk about something about that actually. But anyway, let's get in with like the 6 couples and then we'll continue. So first we're going to start with the first couple that got together. Oh, it is sunny. I'm a car. I'm in Florida. It's hot. I'm going blind. My phone will overheat in like 5 seconds. It's fine. So we have Danielle and Nick. Nick, I don't hate him. I don't love him. Because he gives me like instigator vibes. He gives me like, he likes a little bit of gossip here and there. As you can see, when they start grouping up, he loves being like, you should go talk to Mallory Jarrett. You should like, oh my gosh, Shayna. Like, Natalie's being so overprotective of Shayna. Like, he's very gossipy. And I don't know if he's doing that out of his own accord. I don't know if he was edited that way or if the producers are like, hey, we need a little bit of drama. Nick, you need to like go over there and talk to go over there and talk to Shayna. Go over there and talk to Jarrett. So that way we can get a little bit of like, you know, some stuff for the show. So I'm not gonna like judge him based off of that, because other than that, I think he's really sweet. He does get into a lot of arguments with Danielle, but I feel like Danielle's kind of doing that, because like she reminds me so much of myself in a way, because I'm really super insecure. Like, I know I don't seem it, I'm on YouTube, that's probably why. But she's like super insecure like me about like her weight, because I've recently lost like 80-90 pounds, and I'm still like not done with my weight loss journey. I've taken a break from it because I've lost a significant amount of weight and I'm trying to live in that right now. Kind of learn to love myself where I am. And I think that Danielle needs not therapy, maybe some therapy, like, to be honest, but like, I just think she needs to face her insecurities before she faced a relationship. You know what I mean? When I was like younger, I remember there was like, you should love yourself before you can love anyone else kind of thing. And I feel like Danielle's kind of struggling with loving herself, and she's projecting, I've also done this, like this is why I'm saying it, and she's projecting those negative emotions onto her relationship with Nick. And I feel like it's because they don't know each other. They met, and my phone's gonna fall, so we're just gonna pretend it's not falling, but they met in the pods, and it seems like theirs was like quicker than even like Cameron and Lauren. Like 2 days they were like, yes, this is my wife, this is my husband kind of thing. And I feel like that kind of contributes to maybe their lack of trust. Like, maybe they should have spent more time in the pods. I think that maybe they should try couples therapy, not because they're on the rocks or anything, because obviously they're a very new couple in the show. But like, I feel like couple therapy in the show would probably help each contestant realize their own kind of like weaknesses and fears in order to really be able to see how they feel emotionally ready enough for a relationship. And I feel like that's something Danielle might have needed. And maybe with Nick it would have been better, because like, you know, they start on a trusting foundation, because she seems to, if he just leaves her alone, believe that he's a cheater, he's doing this, he's doing that, he doesn't love her. He's very much someone who shows his emotions inwardly, and like, I feel like maybe through physical contact for reassurement, because like whenever she's like upset, he like hugs her to reassure her, he like tries to talk to her about it. But I just think that they're an interesting couple. I think they'll be okay. I don't know if they're like forever. I know that they did get married, so we'll see how that continues to go. But definitely no couple this season was a Lauren and Cameron, just kind of like beautiful, like, you know. So that's unfortunate. But then that was Danielle, Nick. I feel like I focused a lot on like not them as people, outside of the relationship, but within the relationship, and then, like, more on Danielle, because I related to her a lot, but I'm also, like, younger, so, and I'm looking at it from the outside, so I can see, like, the kind of where she's coming from, but I just felt like sometimes her fights were just, like, why? Like, he's done nothing. Like, he's very much trying. And I know some people are saying, like, well, he's not faultless in the relationship. And I don't think he's faultless. I just think that she needs to overcome some of her own battles before we can just judge both of them as a couple, you know? And so next, let's talk a little bit about Shayna. Shayna and Kyle, they're quick. Kyle, sir. Kyle. I know that they had a lot of similar family life. Like, oh my gosh, my dad's in construction. Oh, I'm in construction. My brothers do construction. Great, great. Love that. You have a lot of similarities as people. But once they got into that conversation about religious and him being an atheist and her being very, 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 very Christian, I understand why he says we can work through it. Because there are couples like that. Like, my mom is Catholic. My dad's Christian. We're Christian Catholic. Like, I was raised Christian Catholic. But that doesn't... Like, mine, they both were religious in some sense, so it was easier, especially being those two religions for, a lot of people say that's hard, but, like, I don't know, my parents seem fine, but I just think that if he seems to be okay with anything. He was a vegetarian, he ate steak for this woman, he was vegetarian for 8 years, I believe, and this man ate steak for this woman who literally, when they met, was like, I don't know if we should get married. And he was like, oh my gosh, I think we're gonna do great. I think we're gonna get over so much stress. No, Kyle, no, you're not. No, you're not. And I think that proposal was, oh, I was like watching her, and he was like so confident. He was so, and she was just like, she looked like she wanted to run. Like, she wanted to, like, run, never go back in that room. And then she was like, it's because you gave me your mom's ring. I couldn't say, you could have said no. You could have said no because you would have never seen this man again. You would have never had to deal with this. But you decided, I'm going to just say yes because I feel peer pressure. From who? From yourself, because you couldn't end up with Shane. Shane, oh my God. From the producers, because maybe they want to keep things a little spicy in there. Or, like, why did you feel pressured? Because it's, I get that it's the mom's ring. I do. But you've never seen this man in your life. And if you said no, you would have never seen him again. And you would never know what he looks like until you watch the show. So you would have been very easily able to avoid each other for the rest of your lives. That's it. That was all for Shayna. Also, stop trying to stir the pot in other people's relationships. Like, you could tell some of these relationships weren't going to last. So you didn't have to do that. Again, I feel like producers were like, Shayna, we need you, like, to make some interesting points for us to, like, have things for the television or whatever. But, like, girl, you just ended up looking so bad. I did like you a little bit better at the reunion. I felt a little bit better about you because you weren't being so, like, conflict like Jessica was season one. I guess they were trying to turn you into Jessica, but, like, you did not let that happen. You said, I'm not Jessica, and you called it a day. So thank you for that. Love you for doing that. But, like, girl, what were you doing? I was, oh, my goodness. Anyway, let's talk a little bit about Shane and Natalie, love her. Like, I would be friends with her. Why would you pick... I want to know what kind of conversations Natalie and Shane had to make her feel so strongly about him, you know? I can tell, like, when he was talking to, like, Shayna versus Natalie, Shayna felt more like booty call, like, haha, let's flirt, like, let's meet up, have, like, a one-night stand kind of... good for you, date for a few months, break up, have very toxic relationship vibes over there. And then Natalie was more like marriage material, meet the parents. And I feel like maybe that's why he chose her. But I want to know why Natalie chose him. Like, I wish they showed us more nuanced conversations with him and Natalie to show, like, he does have a mature side and he does have, like, a depth to him. Because Natalie feels very intelligent, very, like, boss woman, like, very strong, independent energy. My phone overheated, so I have no idea where I was. So let's talk a little bit about Shane. Because I feel like we talked a little bit about Natalie, but like Shane gives me some. Shane scares me. Like, just start right in there. Shane really scares me. He gives me a lot of like relationship vibes. He gives me like he would verbally wear me out. I would be so like so trying to please him because he just really scared me personally. That's just like a me instinct. Like, obviously everyone has different perceptions because I know some people love Shane for his personality, but like for me that was like he was really scary, especially when he and Natalie had the fight the night before their wedding. And I was like, what was the fight about? Like, oh my gosh, because this woman was like shaking. She was like shaking and I was like So yeah, Shane was a little scary to me, but I know everyone has different perceptions of him. I know he has some stans, so his stans, please don't kill me. That was just my personal reaction to him. I'm really surprised he got two women. I think that was like really surprising to see, because I think that like the Shane joke and like they were just really hyping him up to be that annoying kind of guy. But then enter Shake. Shake really said, I am here to be the TV show villain. I am here to create the drama, to create the scandal. And he did. And he's a very narcissistic, rude, egocentric person from, again, the telling of him via television. He could be different. I just don't think he is. I think that he is really like that, especially seeing them in the reunion and everyone, even Shane, who scared me, was like, absolutely not with this. Absolutely not with this piece of garbage. So I didn't like Shake at all. I found Shake's mom to be a true icon. Like, I love this woman. She was like, Deep T does not deserve 0.5% less. And I was like, yes. Her mom was like, you are my son, but I know you and you are a jerk. And I think she deserves better than you. And she was an icon for that. For saying that, true icon, like the truest queen there. Like, I was like, okay, I loved his mom. Hate him, love his mom. But yeah, so I just think he is a really bad person. He really would bring out so much body dysmorphia, like, to other people. Like, he would really just not fuel good vibes. So the fact that Deep D was able to connect with him on a deeper level and he still turned out to be a horrible person to someone who gave him so many chances, I was just like, I can't. And then at the wedding, you could tell he was visibly hurt. But then he was here, like, talking to all the guests, being like, if I was first, like, we would have also not got married. But, like, you know, like, if she said yes, I would have felt like I had to say yes. I'm like, no, you were going to say yes because she's a great woman. And you don't deserve her. And you don't deserve anyone better, anyone less than her, because, like, you just don't deserve to be with anyone with that personality. Like, you need some therapy, like, some good therapy before you go with anyone. Especially at the reunion, what he said was disgusting about, like, I'm not attracted to anyone here besides Vanessa. One, Vanessa's married. Two, she's the host. Three, no one asked. No one. You insert yourself in every single situation. And it was like, why? Why? No one wanted that. No one wanted to hear you. No one wanted you to be there. So please stop talking, because no one's watching for you. That's it. Deep D, love her. She was poised. She was elegant. She was intelligent. She was polite. She also, when I saw the food that her family was making, I was like, that's some banging food. Man, it made me, I love Indian food. So it was like some banging food. I was like, oh. But I loved her. She was just so nice. I was like, I don't understand how you ended up with this man, because you're so nice and you're so smart. And at the reunion, when Kyle was like, I should have chose Deep D over Shayna, I was like, they're not even in the same like realm. Those two women, not the same at all. I feel like we didn't get to see Kyle in other relationships, so maybe he and Deep D did have a really good connection, and maybe that makes a lot of sense for him to say. But since we as the audience never saw that, I just felt like he was really trying to like make sure he got some screen time in this reunion. I'm just gonna end there with that comment. But I just, she does so much better. She's going to get better. Like, we already know she's going to get like a man that treats her the way she deserves to be treated and treats her above 100%, because that's what she deserved. And Shake deserves no one and nothing. Okay, moving on. Let's talk about Sal. Sal is my favorite. Sal was the first person I followed. It was episode 3, and I was like, I'm following this man on Instagram. he is, I love this man. He's not only attractive, he's not only sweet, he's like so, like, I don't know, he's very comforting. Like his little cheesy cute songs he wrote for Mallory all the time, and like him kind of introducing her to his family and like his sisters, and he was just so, he didn't deserve that. Like, he did not deserve, he and Deep D for me, they were like the ones who did not deserve 0.5% less than what like they should have gotten on this show. Like, they both were just so sweet, and the fact that like Mallory, you were engaged already and you were still flirting with Jarrett when his fiance 10 feet away, your fiance 10 feet away, and then you act like Sal's being too sensitive, but he's actually being very perceptive because you did feel those things for Jarrett, and you would break up with him if Jarrett were to break up with Diana as soon as you met him in person. I could tell like that you were just not. So yeah, I love Sal. He's so nice. Like, his voice is so good. I just, this man deserved better. This man was like when he broke up with her at the altar, because that's how you like choose if you want to stay together or not at the end, and he apologized to her family, I thought that was like the most sweet, most gentleman thing to do. And like he was even trying to not like embarrass her, and like, I don't know, like, I really like Sal. Like, I think he deserved better. Like, he was so nice and gentle and genuine, and I feel like, again, like, he just did not get lucky. My mom just saw a car speed by down the road. That was fun. She's outside. She's on the little patio with my father. How cute, old people gallery. I'm sorry. Okay. Mal. I, in the beginning, really liked Mal, and I also thought her relationship was more genuine with Jarrett in the pod, so I was really surprised when she chose Sal, because it was just really surprising to me. Like, she and Jarrett just had that thing going back and forth, so the fact that she chose Sal was really surprising. And then, like, when she got into real life, it was, like, giving the same vibes of, like, the Jessica situation of, like, will she choose to marry him? Will she not choose to marry him? Like, you know, like, going back and forth, like, what is going on? Like, girl, like, this man, like, proposed to you, and the first thing you do when you see him is you're like, I'm not sure if I'm sexually attracted to him. You know how many comments I've seen of women being like, how are you not sexually attracted to Sal? Like, that was so many comments I saw on the internet, and I agree. That's where I end that. But like, she was just giving me like concerning vibes of so, I really liked her in the pods. When they got out of the pods is when I got more concerned, because I was like, she was so like in the pods when it's just them, it was great. Like, she was so like, I loved her voice. Like, she has such a calming voice, which is so nice. And like, she seemed like someone people could trust, and like, you could tell that she was going through it. Like, I felt like definitely on her side she was probably going through a lot of emotion, and it was probably very overwhelming. But the fact that like you meet Jarrett and you just flirt with him, and you guys had like a long conversation with your spouses like right there, and I was like, I just think like maybe having that little bit more self-awareness would have been great. But I do, like, I don't hate her, because obviously she was someone I really liked when she was in the pods, and like, I just wish that would have continued on. I do think it makes sense that they didn't end up together. Like, they don't seem like they would. They seem like they could be really good friends, but like, marriage-wise, I didn't really see it. But so I think that made sense. Let's talk a little bit about Jarrett and Ayana. I love Ayana. Like, she's so wholesome. Like, she gives me like little sister vibes. Like, she's so cute, she's so nice. I think like her trauma, like, I was gonna say what she went through, and being able to share that on like live, like television, like people could stream that, was so brave to do. And the fact that she was just so open to the process, and even after Jarrett had almost proposed to someone else, still being able to accept that because they were compatible, and they were like, she really got me. Like, this girl, I was like, Jarrett better be like the man she deserves. Like, he needs to do better, because she didn't deserve that. And the fact that, like, they are still married right now is, like, a good sign, and I hope it continues that way, because they were the only couple after that thing with Mallory, with the, like, he didn't get you a gold ring, I would have gotten you a gold ring. Shut up, okay? No, you haven't. No. So that, with, yeah, anyway, I just think, like, with the Mallory, that was kind of rude of him to say, like, I would have got you a gold ring. Because, like, Sal got the ring before, like, they even had that conversation. Sal was concerned about the ring, and it was a whole thing. And the fact that you just, like, brought up, like, a salted wound, and even, like, again, you were engaged, and you still did that. I was like, no. But I love Diana. I think that he better be the man that she deserves. He better have been doing better. I loved him as a person. Like, as a person, he'd be such a fun friend. Like, honestly, like he'd be that hype man that every girl needs in their friend group. The one who's like, girl, what do you mean? You're, like, the baddest. Like you need someone like Jarrett in your life. Relationship-wise, a little concerning. But, like, I think as the show progressed, you could tell that they were probably the one couple that was gonna, like, most definitely get married. Because, like, everyone else was a mess. Everyone else was here with, like, red waving flags. Like, red flags are smacking all these people in the face. Like, all these couples, I was like, there's red flags every minute that you're together. Why are you still together? I don't know how. They were able to, like, be the one couple that was, even after he almost proposed to someone else, how they were the one solid couple in the end. I just could not get, I was like, how did we get here? Like, how did we get here, people? Oh my goodness. But yeah, Jarrett, loved him as a person. Just do better. And I think he did do better, because, like, you could see them in the reunion. Like, he and Ayana seem to be doing significantly better, significantly stronger. And, like, Danielle's, she's getting there. And then Nick is doing better. He's not stirring the pot as much. Thank you for that. Love that. But yeah, so that's kind of, like, my thoughts on every single character of Love is Blind Season 2. When I tell you, I started watching this on my flight to Florida yesterday, and then I got home. I took a 30-minute nap, and I started watching it again. And then I took another 30-minute... Okay, listen. My flight was at 5:30 in the morning. I got 2 hours of sleep. I got 2 hours on the plane, and I got 30 minutes. So somehow I was able to watch this coherently, and then watch so many other people's videos on this. Insane. I love romance. I love, like, shows like this. I love to see love and love to see people happy and finding their significant other. I don't know why. I think I'm just a sap that way. I think that I just want that in the future. I'm, like, 22. I'm not getting married, like, now. So, but I just like seeing it, because one day I do want, like, that love in the future. And that's why I like the show. I do think there are some ways the show could be stronger. Like, I think Love is Blind is a great concept, but I feel like the pods part is really short. So maybe, like, kind of taking maybe some of the quote-unquote good qualities of other dating reality shows, kind of, like, taking that approach of, I hate 90 Day Fiancé, not 90 Day Fiancé, Married at First Sight. I think mixing a little bit of Married at First Sight with Love is Blind would make Love is Blind a little bit stronger, and by that I mean, like, I like that they put them back in the real world. Alrighty, okay, the final time before my phone actually, like, hates me, because it's starting to hate me. I think couples therapy would be really good. I think having, like, moments of growth, like, too hot to handle, like, individual self-growth would be really important, like, reflectivity kind of things, would really help. I feel like maybe them grow trust in themselves, but also in their relationships, because I feel like that's something that this show needs, because these people need, like, someone to talk to, rather than, like, either lashing out at each other, being like, this experiment doesn't work, or, like, finding ways to cope as an adult and actually, like, communicate is one thing I think they need a little bit more of. But yeah, that's kind of, like, one thing I think they could improve on. But overall, again, I just love, but if you If you guys like this kind of video, let me know. Because obviously I do reactions on the channel where I watch shows. You can comment some down below that you want me to watch. But I can also do these sort of things where I finish watching something and I talk about it, because I'm always watching something. I'm literally about to watch the last episode of season 2 of Cheer. And I do like movie/TV show reviews on my podcast all the time. So again, like, I can do stuff like this on the channel as well. If you all like it, just let me know. And yeah, with that, thanks so much for watching my first ever kind of retelling summary thoughts of a show. And let me know what you all want to see next. If you're here for Escape the Night was already recorded. I have like 3 pre-recorded things I set for it just in case. So for some of you going like for the first time in forever, I literally keep singing that line because I have recorded videos for you, Escape the Night fans, don't worry. But yeah, with that, I will see you in the next one. Bye.